You know, when you are introduced by saying that you've done this and you've done that, most of the people in the audience misunderstand that you have answers to all the questions. It's in the digital world, in the physical world, it's about a discovery process, yeah. So I just want to clarify that I don't have all the answers. I normally don't do a PPT, but since my voice was, I was losing my voice, I said I will take the crutch of a PPT, yeah? So my PPT is going to be very conceptual because that's safe for me, yeah? But if you believe that, you know, I have answers to some questions, do ask questions at the end of it. I'll be much more practical and grounded at that time because this is going to be up in the air and conceptual, yeah? So disrupt or get disrupted. I don't know whether being a part of Jio, which is what I am the CHRO for, yeah, is really appropriate. I don't know whether Jio has done that, but we believe we have. And therefore, standing up here and talk about disrupt or get disrupted. The right one, right? Ah. If you look at the pace of change, yeah, typically what you see here, yeah, and look at the mobile payment to virtual currency bit, yeah. It's happened so rapidly that all of us were caught completely off guard. And that's really what's happening. Where the disruption will come from, we don't even know. It could be tomorrow a small startup and which becomes a revolution and all of us get benefit or affected by it. Yeah. So what are some of the consequences to it? Yeah. So what are the changes that are happening? Yeah. So from web to digital apps, and all of us have seen that change, and we are beneficiaries of it. From platforms to Internet of Things. Internet of Things is yet to come, but it's all in the air, and it's already going to affect all of us. From monolithic systems, yeah, all of us have had the benefit of SAP and Oracle and whatever else it is, yeah, it's now coming to microsystems. And that's going to change a lot in terms of technology and the way we work and the way the organizations get structured. From mobile to wearable devices, yeah, and that's going to have a significant impact. From social media to dark social, yeah. We are still grappling with how to handle social media because reputations and non-reputations get created and done overnight. And therefore, what we are moving towards is what is called as dark media, and we have not yet even idea of how to manage or handle it. From VVM to augmented reality, yeah, augmented reality, particularly people in the fashion business will get the benefit of it, but a lot's going to change thereof. And of course, digital payments, e-commerce to blockchain, et cetera, et cetera. So what are some of the impacts as far as the business or the organization is concerned? Yeah. So there is no divide going to be there between, you know, digital and physical. And therefore the world will become physical and digital. And that's in itself a challenge. And we've seen large organizations, yeah, who are in e-commerce have moved to physical and physical organization moving to e-commerce. So therefore it's not a matter of choice. It's going to be how the world is going to be. Direct to customer, yeah, that's something that is going to happen. Customers are going to start accessing services directly. And the day will not be far. Today we access most of our services directly. We use various e-commerce platform to access our services. But tomorrow, the brand owners, yeah, the world that we'll see is customers accessing the brand owners directly. And they maybe they'll not need somebody in between called as the e-commerce. Yeah, and that's where the world will go. Global, customer-led, et cetera, I mean, that continues, of course. What's the impact on the organization? It's going to be AI-driven. Yeah, we are going to depend a lot on data and data analytics and data modeling, et cetera. And therefore, a lot of things that were the domain of individuals, of human beings who had that knowledge is going to go into a machine, and therefore a lot of predictive work is going to be done by a machine, and that has an impact on the organization anyway. You'll see a world where there'll be people working in small teams, yeah? And that has a significant impact on the way we organize ourselves. And I live that world today in Jio. From a large organization, how we have now have small teams working together, and there are consequences to it. Yeah, proactive, customer-led, et cetera, you know, yeah. As far as people impact is concerned, yeah, we live a life which is digital in nature. And therefore, like I said, direct to customer, direct to employees is what's happening. And therefore, employees are wanting to have self-service, employees are wanting no layers in between in terms of access. And that's what we are seeing increasingly. Yeah, self-service, empowerment, we talked about it. New jobs getting created. The significant thing is going to be, there is going to be a huge amount of skill gap. And what we are grappling with today is really what is that new world and what is the new skill sets that are going to require, that are going to be required. Pardon my voice. Yeah, this is called the Industrial Revolution 4.0. So from mechanical to electrical to internet and now to digital. That's the age that we are talking about. The important thing is, you know, we are still talking about scalable efficiency, but what the world is moving towards is scalable adaptability. So adaptability at a scale, yeah, which is really what we'll see emerging, and that's going to be a huge challenge as far as managing people in particular is concerned. So what are the skill gaps? What are the skills that are going to be there for the future? Yeah, and what you'll see is these are going to be skills which are largely going to be life skills. Because most of the things will get automated. Most of the things will become predictive through more and more data that we are going to get. It's going to impact HR folks also. And since a lot of HR folks here, the only question that I get confronted with every single day is a lot of people walking up to me and saying, sir, I have no job to do any longer. What should I do? And it's something that is very significant. It's not only going to happen in HR, but HR in particular, because HR, as a discipline, we were never data-oriented. And today, everything is going towards data. And therefore, a mind shift change as well as skill set change is what's going to be required. And there were life skills in terms of critical thinking, social intelligence, and design thinking. And let me try to explain that. So what are those 10 skills that we require in the future? Yeah, I think I'll take the help of my slides because... Some of the skills, when I was going through it, I don't even know what they mean. But once you describe them, you know actually what they are all about. So sense making, yeah, ability to determine deeper meaning and significance of what is being expressed. Yeah, quite a tongue twister, I don't even understand, but that's what is going to be critical. Social intelligence, ability to connect with others in a deep and direct way. Probably this is something that we understand. But connecting with each other in a deeper way digitally is really what's going to happen. New media literacy, yeah, I think all of us are grappling with that. Ability to critically assess and develop content that uses new media forms. And therefore, if you look at learning, yeah, and learning has undergone a tremendous change. And a lot of new media is being used. In fact, at Jio, we employ about 150,000 people. And when I was told that, you know, we are going to onboard so many people and we have got to train them, the only way I have trained people is through classrooms. And somebody said, no, we will do it on the mobile. And I said, no, that's not possible. That's not the way people learn. So they told me to step aside and say that, sir, aapko samajh bhi nahi aata. Okay. And content was created, content that was very easily consumable. And people consume that content very regularly, 100% of the people actually subscribe to it. Thank God I stepped aside, because that's not the world that I have lived in. But in today's world, I've seen it, people are very, very comfortable consuming the content digitally. And the beauty of it is that they actually get certified and actually do a good job of it. So to me, it was quite a revelation in terms of how people take to new media. Virtual collaboration, I think that's something that will happen more and more. Ability to work productively, drive engagement, etc. So again, giving the Jio example, we are so widely spread. Yeah, 11,000 cities and towns of India where we are physically present, our employees are physically present. How do you create an organization which is so widely spread and therefore so remote, and you still maintain the high touch? Because technology, though it enables, it also can alienate people. And therefore, high touch is something that is very important. And a simple thing, I remember somebody coming and telling me, onboarding of people, yeah, HR folks will understand, takes about half a day, or used to take about half a day. We decided that we need to make sure that people are productive on the same day. Then we said that people should get productive within 2 hours of joining. And therefore, everything that is to be done, as far as training is concerned, induction is concerned, etc., happens digitally before the person joins. And actually, the onboarding process takes only 3 minutes, because there is the PF form that you need to sign in ink, and therefore that's the only thing that happens. So people who are responsible for onboarding were saying, what do I do now? So I said, this is an opportunity for you to connect deeply with people, use some high touch moments. So what they do currently is, as soon as a person gets onboarded, we do a video call with the family and show the family what the office is all about, who the boss is, and et cetera, et cetera. Yeah? And therefore, there are moments where technology enables, there are also moments where technology enables you to continue to be high touch. Yeah, this slide I like. Not because I created it, but I think it says everything. So it's about moving away from fixed mindset to growth mindset. Yeah, I think that's quite obvious, all of us know that. Earlier it was focusing on predictability and efficiency, focus on speed to value. That's really what the change is all about. A rigid and structured approach to agile, agile organization, it's a nice word, but doing an organization which is agile is very, very difficult. And it's all related to mindset, it's not related to structure, and therefore, the kind of culture you create will decide whether your organization is agile or not, responsive or not. Prioritization of predefined outcomes, from that to prioritization of learning and progress. Why learning and progress? Because organizations of tomorrow will have to continuously learn and learn and learn. It's not about unlearn and relearn, it's about continuing to learn and learn, because there are newer and newer insights that are going to come about, and therefore it's all about learning, and therefore prioritization is going to be about learning. We had functional experts, deep understanding of a subject. The world that we live in today will be a world where depth and breadth is both going to be important. Sometimes you said general management is good, sometimes you said functional management is good. In tomorrow's world, both together is going to be very, very important. Development and education focus to innovation and design focus. Maybe innovation is not the right word, but evolving is the right word. People will have to continuously evolve, organizations will have to be continuously evolving, and therefore what worked yesterday will not work tomorrow, it will become a reality. And therefore it's about a flow, it's not about innovation, it's about flowing, it's about doing new things every day, because new things are going to come up every day. And lastly, of course, willingness to challenge status quo. I said willingness to challenge status quo, but it's not about that. It's about things are going to change so much that there is nothing called a status quo that is going to be. So everything is going to be concurrent. Yeah. So it's what I call as present continuous. And to me, that's the world that we are going to grapple with. I think collectively at the end of the day, possibly we'll have some answers to it. Yeah. Thank you. If at all, any questions?
Any questions? We'll be happy to pass you a microphone.
Hello, Mr. Sanjay. My name is Arun. You mentioned about digital onboarding and learning continuously and all that. So what was the challenge or overall experience from that? You said, did they actually were able to learn quickly, but did you face any challenges or people not wanting to do in that method or anything, if you can share?
See, the first most important thing that people, as an organization, you grapple with is, you know, how can my information go out? If I'm sending a link to somebody, my information is gone, okay? So that's the first thing that you grapple with in terms of saying that this is secret. But you know, if you go to YouTube, you'll find everything anyway. So that's the first mindset issue. The second is in terms of people actually doing it. Yeah. So that was the next challenge. And therefore, how do you make sure that you motivate people to actually take that program? Yeah. How do you make sure that people actually answer questions at the end of it? How do you make sure that people understand this is not a nice thing to do, it's a necessary thing to do? So that is the second thing that we grappled with. The third thing was resistance from within, and that always is there, by saying that, agar ye sab automate ho gaya, toh mera kya hoga, kind of thing, yeah. But, you know, for me, my answer to that was always fundamental, saying that you joined the HR profession because you wanted to make difference in people's lives. Today you have the opportunity to do so rather than doing the mundane work of, you know, onboarding and stuff like that. And therefore go back to your basics. Yeah. So those are some of the things that happen. But to tell you frankly, people take to it very easily. The prospective employees, we onboard about 1,000 people a day. It's quite simple. So it's not a challenge in terms of the potential candidate. More challenges are internal, yeah.
Sanjay, hey, this is Kumar. yeah. So I've got a question for you. Since as Reliance, you are known as people who know how to execute projects really well. There are three aspects to running businesses that I think is very relevant for most of us. One is, what are the new rules for making sure that project successes are being taken care of? Success in project, and how do you manage those teams? One. Second thing is, what happens to chain of command? Because I think the way chain of command is in the current day and age is very different than what you used to be. And the third part to it, which is also a thing attached to it, is how do you then look at assessment of people, and how often do you do it? Is goal setting as easy an exercise as setting up a goal start of the year and doing an assessment end of the year? So how do you manage this?
I'll start with the last one. So, performance assessment, or for that matter, goal setting. Difficult question to answer because what you need, or what we do at least, I don't know what needs to be done, is we make sure that we have aligned people to a very large goal, saying that 100 million customers in 180 days. Okay, so that's the large goal. Gone is the time when you can attach people to a small goal because it's so ever-changing. So that's the context. But our technology allows us to monitor performance of every individual, yeah, in real time. So we have these great dashboards in the company when you, all around, yeah. Where as soon as a customer gets onboarded, you know, there is a pop-up that comes, and which state it is in, probably we can go down to which retailer it is in, and of course, down to who's the person kind of thing, yeah. And therefore, real-time information allows for performance assessment daily. Okay, so it's a real-time world where you know where you stand or what you've done, okay? The consequence of that is not many of us are comfortable with a real-time world, because every time to know that you're doing well or not doing well is not a happy situation to be in. But it's a mindset issue. Yeah, it took some time before people started enjoying that. Yeah, so appraisals in the formal sense, yeah, are more towards feedback now, which we'll end up doing. And there is a good formal process for that. But it's not about assessment, which is related to numbers, et cetera, because that's available. Okay, so that's the first answer to the, third question. I forgot the other two, as usual. Sorry?
The first one was about
project management. Yeah.
And how do you set teams for that? Or rather, the effectiveness, because the whole team is responsible for a project.
Yeah. So when you say that you want to achieve 100 million customers in 180 days, yeah, it's a tough task. It's a tough task because nobody's done it before. So that's the first reference point. Secondly, it's never happened in the world. So the target can appear stupid, foolish, or saying that it's motivating. And therefore, that's the first hurdle. And therefore, people who have been there, done that, yeah, it just doesn't work. So anybody who has a mindset of being there, done that, doesn't have any place, because there are no reference point in the past to achieve something like an audacious goal. Okay, so that's about the mindset. And therefore, getting that over is the first step, and then to project management, et cetera, yeah. There is no shortcut to detailing. Yeah. And therefore, all programs are created centrally, which are almost to zero defection level. And local execution, it almost acts like an army, saying that this is the objective. And see, real-time world allows you to course correct also. And therefore, though it is very, very well set in terms of processes and which are very watertight, it allows you to change, because you can change from hour to hour if there is a need, because the real-time world gives you that feedback. So it is rigid at one end, but it becomes flexible because you can course correct every hour almost. Yeah. So that's the short answer to it. Otherwise, the typical project management techniques, et cetera, we do all that. Yeah. What was the third?
Second question was related to that. It's about the chain of command. Because when you start doing things on projects, the effectiveness of a project team is dependent upon various things that should happen for them. The traditional sense of chain of command, does it really have any impact anymore, or does it not have any impact?
So I think 4 years back when we started the business or started getting the business together, we decided we'll create an organization which is a fractal-based organization, which means our lowest point will look exactly like our whole organization. Yeah. And therefore, we created an organization which is, we operate as one NHQ, four regions, 28 states, further grouped into 93 areas, which manage what are called as 1,100 of our offices called Jio Centers. These are not customer-facing entities. The Jio Center was the lowest point as far as the organization was concerned. It had all the skills, capabilities that existed in the center, except branding and marketing. Yeah. So whether it was customer care, whether it was network, whether it was construction, everything. So all the capabilities existed there. And therefore, to that extent, it was an independent unit. We also made sure that it will be an independent unit by making sure that everybody in that unit was local. So we almost were rigid about it by saying that, because the ownership is of a different level when everybody is local. Of course, to a large extent, we achieved that. By doing this, the sense of ownership was tremendous. We then replicated it further, and today we have about 7,000 odd what we call a geo points, which is another minuscule of entity, which also has all the skills and capabilities except the construction capability, because it's not required at that level, which becomes a unit. And therefore, our approach is very unitized in nature. And that self-contained unit knows how it is performing, and therefore, it doesn't really require guidance on a day-to-day basis to run that unit, because they know what the network health is, to what the sales numbers are, to what the care issues are, what the retailers' issues are, et cetera, et cetera. And the capability exists to solve the issue. Okay. We run what is called as an operations center at the center. Okay. So nobody sends emails to anybody. You log in whatever you want to log in as a request or a query to this portal. Let's call it a portal for a moment, which we call as the OC, Operations Center. And that portal resolves the issue for you. The beauty of it is that there are experts who have already, done all the use cases. So 90% of the time, the answer is always there, and it comes auto almost, because we have bots which work on it, and you get the answers. Whatever is not there, somebody who's a subject matter expert, intervenes and does it. But that's not all. So suppose I'm solving a problem and I'm making an exception for a particular retailer, okay? The exception that I make is available real time in terms of information to everybody in the system. And therefore, you're very careful in terms of making an exception, because it becomes a rule for the entire country. Whether it's an HR issue, whether it's a sales issue, whether it's a supply chain issue, et cetera. And an organization of that scale, it is extremely important that you follow this mechanism, which is transparent in nature, because as soon as I solve the problem, it becomes a rule for everybody. Okay. The other thing that we did was, suppose a particular product is not reached our retailer, and the retailer is calling up saying that mera maal kab aayega, okay? Somebody in the system already knows that there is a delay because there was an accident of the vehicle or something like that, So I have a reactive operation center. You need to have an operation center which is far more proactive, or which is only proactive for that matter. And therefore, the retailer will proactively get informed ki instead of 9 o'clock, your stuff is going to arrive at 11 o'clock, okay? And this happens in everything, whether it's HR, whether it's sales, whether it is care, et cetera, et cetera. And therefore, empowerment, people are empowered because there is somebody who's there to answer the question. There is no supervisor required to manage that. And therefore, when I talked about the world which is direct to customer, direct to employees, this is the world that we are talking about. I don't know whether I've answered your question, but